Your Steve Jones Show podcast will start shortly. The Steve Jones Show podcast is sponsored by Brewers Outlet, your beverage supermarket on Reagan Street in Sunbury. Sports talk where your voice counts. This is the Steve Jones Show on News Radio 1070 WKOK. Now from the Sunbury Motor Studio, here's Steve Jones.
All right, first Saturday in May. That can only mean one thing. Well, maybe two. Maybe three. Mint juleps, hats, and the Kentucky Derby. That also means a fourth. Dick Jerardi, EJ.
Steve, all of those are true. I'm not sure the correct order. But
my order is the race first.
All right, well, let's do that. Ain't no hats around here.
You and I aren't wearing any hats.
Only mint julep I ever tasted was at my first derby, and it was one taste and one and done.
Gone. And I would be the same way.
Boy, was it brutal. Oh, my Lord. It looked bad and tasted worse.
Yeah, it's not up my alley either. So that's done. This is a race where Bob Baffert is not allowed to hang around, yet his spirit hangs around. Is that fair?
More than fair. So after they go under the wire a little bit after 7 o'clock Saturday, Steve, Baffert will then be able to reappear at Churchill Downs. His suspension is over. After this year's Derby, he's only suspended from Churchill Downs tracks at the moment. He can run horses anywhere.
Right.
So I'm sure I'll have something at Preakness, possibly the Belmont. But he does have a horse that he trained in the race, Reincarnate. He's listed 50-1. I don't think he's going to be 50, but Baffert was the trainer of record till late February when he had to give the horse up so the horse could earn Derby points to get in. Is now trained by Tim Yakteen. And Johnny V will ride. And of course, Johnny V was on board.
Yeah.
For Authentic in 2020 when Baffert won Derby 6, and he was on for Medina Spirit when he won Derby 7 for a little while.
For an hour.
Yeah, and then it's, believe it or not, that's still being adjudicated. It's not finalized. I mean, he's been formally disqualified, but you'll be surprised that there's court cases going on. Oh. And, of course, because of the positive for the medication that shouldn't have been in the horse's system, Medina Spirit was disqualified, and then Churchill Downs took the unprecedented move of, all right, you're gone for 2 years. So let's just get rid of the most famous guy in the sport and make it look like he's Lance Armstrong. And that'll help everybody. So it's just kind of, whole thing's been kind of baffling to me, but it's over as of 7 p.m. Saturday.
All right. So as for the horses out there,
yes.
I believe is it Forte 40?
Yeah, Forte.
Forte 3-1.
People are saying, yep, Forte
3-1.
Yep. Yeah, so it's interesting, Steve. Todd Fletcher's brought 62 horses to the Derby. He's won. he's won twice.
Yeah.
But people will look at it as 2 for 62. But realistically, he's been in 22 races. I mean, he's had years where he's had 4 or 5. Obviously, if he has 4 or 5, only one can win.
Yeah,
and interesting. So I look at him as 2 for 22, and interestingly, he's only had one favorite all those years. Always Dreaming, who actually won the race.
Yeah.
So Forte would be the second horse he's ever had that's favored, and of all the horses he's brought, this is by far the most accomplished.
Is this the Florida Derby winner?
It is. Yeah. A 2-year-old champ, won the Breeders' Cup, has won 5 in a row. What's interesting about him? Out of the 20 horses, there's 7 total grade 1 wins, which, as you know, is the top of the sport.
Yeah.
Well, Forte has 4 of the 7. So just by accomplishments, it's not even close. So he should be the favorite. The problem is that he's going to be the favorite in a race that looks more wide open to me. He isn't Justify or American Pharoah or California Chrome. He doesn't have that kind of dominant horse. And by the numbers, Steve, he hasn't gotten any faster than he was 6 months ago.
Okay.
So can he win? Sure. Obviously, he's a horse that likes to win.
Right.
I am going to play against him because I just think the price is going to be wrong. Plus, 20-horse field, he's probably going to be, I don't know, 12th, 13th early.
Yeah.
Not really the place you want to be coming from way back. I know Rich Strike won from there last year, but that was a complete and total fluke.
Who is that horse? All right.
Number 21, Blackjack. Yeah, that's
who he was. In a 20-horse field, Blackjack won.
Right. In 20-horse field, he was number 21. Yeah. I should sum it up right there.
Yeah. Tap It Trice, I think, won the Bluegrass and is... You know, it's another one that's at 5-1. What's the shot here on that one?
Yeah, another Pletcher horse. I think he could be the second choice, Steve, maybe the third choice.
Yeah.
He's a son of Tappet, who's the superstar sire. Yeah. He was actually the 3-year-old the same year as Smarty Jones in 04, sire of Flightline, among many other stars. Sire's Belmont Stakes winner, seemingly, every year. I think Tappet Trice is probably better suited for the Belmont than the Derby. Not that he can't win. He could, and to your point about the Bluegrass, he was pretty good there. I thought that was one of the better preps of the big ones. And Pletcher, believe it or not, the 6 big prep races, the final ones, right, the one, California, Santa Anita Derby, Arkansas, Louisiana, Florida, New York, and Kentucky, Pletcher won 3 of them.
Wow.
He also won with Kings Barnes and Louisiana Derby. He's only started 3 times, so... He's very inexperienced, but the only undefeated horse coming into the race. So Pletcher, again, he started more horses than anybody. This is the strongest group he's ever brought to the race.
Yeah. Now, when you look at Angel of Empire, Practical Move, and then there's the Japanese entry.
Yep.
Dermasotagate.
Yep.
Those are all horses in the 10-1 or up. Any yeah. shots here?
Oh, for sure. Yeah, I mean, Practical Move won the 2 big preps in California.
Yep.
I was very impressed by both. He's also trained by Tim Yakteen, who has Reincarnate, which we just talked about. He took over for Baffert.
Yeah.
But this is a horse he's had the whole time. And he's, on paper, he's not really bred for 1.25 miles, but when he runs, he does not look like the distance will be an issue, so we'll see. Angel of Empire, Steve, I'm not sure you're going to come up with this one, but I'm going to run by you. There are 2 Pennsylvania breds that have won the Kentucky Derby. Angel of Empire is trying to become the 3rd. You should know one of them for sure.
Smarty
Jones. Do you know the other?
The other Pennsylvania bred horse.
To win the Derby.
To
it's
win.
Within the last...
Yeah,
3 decades.
3 decades. No.
Lil E.T.
Lil
E.T. 1992.
How about that?
So Angel of Empire, Brad Cox, who has 4, Brad Cox, the trainer, and Pletcher have a mere 35% of the field.
Yeah.
They have 7 out of 20. Ridden by Flavian Pratt, who is, in my mind, the best big race rider there is right now.
Yep.
So he definitely a contender there. The Japanese horse is fascinating to me. I'm thinking we're saying it's Dermasotagaki, but I've heard a lot different ways.
Yeah,
whatever.
I pronounced it some way. Who knows?
Yeah, in our world, he's the 17th. That's how we're going to look.
Yeah.
So he won the UAE Derby in Dubai on Dubai World Cup Day back in late March, and actually by the clock. Now, they're different distances, but you can kind of figure it out. He ran faster than the winner of the $12 million World Cup,
really?
Which is older horses.
Yeah.
That's pretty impressive. If he can bring that race to Kentucky, he's going to win. And the Japanese are starting to win races all around the world. As I said, they're winning in Dubai, Saudi Arabia. They won 2 Breeders' Cup races at Del Mar. This is by far the best horse they've ever brought to the Derby. Now, the UAE Derby has been a predictor of Derby's failures. It's 0 for life. I mean, and not only do the horses don't win, they run terribly. But I'm kind of looking at this horse a little differently. Even though he won in Dubai, I look at him as a Japanese-trained horse. And I think the crew over there has figured the game out.
Yeah.
So I think he's fascinating. Possibility. But it's more, this is one of the wilder, wide-open derbies I can remember.
Yeah.
There's a lot of possibilities, and it's hard to see the race. Like, you know, who's going to be where
right.
at different points of the race. And that's generally how you can get somewhere. unlike last year when we had that crazy early pace, I don't think we're going to have that this year. There's just not that many fast horses, but there's potential for mayhem here for sure.
Right, exactly. And you and I only know one other person that we know is O for Life, but that's an inside joke.
So yes, it is.
We'll leave it at that. Because it's so wide open, what does this do to the possibility of not long shots, but mid shots?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, no, I think to me, if you're going to make a pick here or make a play, I think you're silly to hang with the favorites here just because, not that Forte can't win, because he certainly can win.
But Forte may fade.
He could do a lot of things. I just don't think he's gotten better in 6 months, and that's what you want. That's
right.
If he had improved from his two-year-old form, Steve, I would make him a cinch.
Yeah.
But he just hasn't. So he can win. And if he does win, I'll be thrilled because that means he'll go to the Preakness in 2 weeks where he can't win, and I'll be able to bet against him as the big favorite because pleasure horses never win the Preakness after they win the Derby.
That's
they run
right.
back in 2 weeks, and he doesn't do that.
Oh, poor life.
Yeah, he is. I mean, I don't even think he wants to be there, but they make him go because he won the Derby.
And, right.
You know, his horse is 8-5 and runs 7th. It's great. So I like the 3. 2 Phils. He's listed at 12 on the line. I think he's going to be higher than that. He's kind of got a semi-unknown trainer who I'm a big fan of, and a semi-unknown rider who I also like. Comes off a win in the Jeff Ruby Stakes. And not Stakes like a stakes horse race,
right.
But stakes as in Jeff Ruby, the restaurant out in Louisville and Cincinnati and all other places. Which, by the way, 1 year the owner, Jeff Ruby, tossed O.J. out of the restaurant.
Gone.
In Louisville. O.J. was in for the Derby.
That's reason enough to like him.
Yeah, he said, nah, not today. Not for you. No stakes for you. But 2 Phils, Steve, I thought it was the best prep of any, and I think people overlook him because it was on a synthetic track.
Yeah.
And people think, well, he can't really run on the dirt, but I like his dirt races. And I most of anything, I like his price. It's a crapshoot because I can't get a sense of where he's going to be in the race.
Yeah.
Like, I much prefer, like, Justify or American Pharoah or California Chrome. You know they're going to be in the top 3.
Right.
So they can't get in trouble. And this horse could potentially be 5th after a quarter mile. He could be 15th. So it's certainly a gamble, but I think there's a possibility he could be the fastest horse in the race by numbers. Mm-hmm. That's my pick. I don't go into it with incredible confidence. Like I had a lot more confidence at Epicenter last year.
Sure.
And of course he won the race until he didn't.
Right.
When that insane 80-1 shot won the race.
Right.
And I'm going, what? Where did you come
from? Excuse me. Go
Who
back.
Who are you?
Go back.
I'm
telling you, that horse was Rosie Ruiz.
I think you're probably right. Just jumped in at the quarter pole, came out of the infield.
Exactly.
Yeah, where was he the first mile? I didn't see him.
Sometimes I look at horses and where they are post position wise and a number that goes with them. Practical Move is 10-1 and in the 10 hole. What do you think of Practical Move?
I think he's a contender. It's interesting. The Saturday Derby, he ends up winning by a nose. Actually, beat another Japanese horse, Mandarin Hero, who's on the also eligible list. He needs a couple scratches to get into the race. And the scratches, by the way, have to happen by Friday at 9 a.m. If they don't happen, that's it. Blocked. It's over.
And then another horse enters and comes in from the quarter pole and wins the race.
That's right. That's exactly right. Yeah. The good news is that he can only run last year. He can't bother us this year. He ended up winning by a nose, Steve, but it's one of those videos when you keep watching, people go, oh, he held on. Well, he never let the horse buy him. They keep running after the finish line.
Yeah.
And I like to look at that just to see who's competitive and who isn't. He's good. He's the best horse in California. And California horses in the Derby have been awesome the last decade. California Chrome, Nyquist, American Pharoah,
right.
Justify, all authentic, all out of Southern California. This year's a little different because the weather was so bad out there. They always have an edge that they don't miss training time like a lot of horses in the East.
Right.
Well, this year they did miss some. So maybe not as big an edge as other years, but Southern California, I always look there. But I'm usually looking at Bob Baffert, right, except he ain't in the race this time.
Right, exactly. By the way, when Penn State plays UCLA and USC in basketball, is there Santa Anita in our future?
I think there's 100% Santa Anita in our future.
I
think we can find a way. In fact, if you're UCLA, we might even get Mick Cronin to go with us. He loves the track.
Perfect. I'm not surprised he'd go.
So, hey, what's a shoot around among friends?
Hey, why do you have assistant coaches?
Exactly.
You don't just pick a winner. You go you go with boxes. So, throw something into a box for us as to what you think.
I'll give you one bomb, reincarnate. If somehow the seven is loose in the lead, he becomes dangerous. I don't know if he's quite good enough, Steve, but in that scenario, he's got a chance.
Yeah.
So he's one. He could be any price. Angel of Empire, the 14 for sure, and 17, Derma Sotagaki. And again, I'm not dismissing Forte at all, but at some point you gotta make a few choices. You can't take them all.
Yeah, and it's a cluster bomb. I mean, that's the other problem.
This is more so than other years because it's just so hard to read how the early part of the race is going to go. I can't see it. And you're waiting for what are the jockeys going to do? This would be one of those where you'd really like to have them. Have maybe a wiretap with some of the jockeys to find out what they're thinking there. Because jockey intentions will have a lot to do with it. But I do think the most likely horse to be in front is Reincarnate, because I think that's what Johnny V will do. That's how he won on Authentic. That's how he won on Medina Spirit. And that's one place you ain't getting any trouble.
Right.
I've said this for years, that speed horses take the biggest issue out of the Derby. If you're first, second, or third, you're in a 3-horse field instead of a 20-horse field.
Right.
If you're 20th or 18th, you got problems.
Kentucky Oaks, just very quickly. What Paint and Botanical, I think, are the two favorites in that. It's not as much. I mean, it's still somewhat of a, there's 14 in there right now.
Yep.
Which is, that's usually the max across the country instead of this, which is 20. I always felt like the Oaks is more predictable because of that. What do you think about the Oaks this year?
Yeah, this is the weakest group of 3-year-old fillies in memory. They're all really slow, Steve. I'm keep waiting for somebody to show up. There's a horse named Money's Gold is actually running on the undercard.
Okay.
Who isn't quite ready for the Oaks. She's the fastest one in the country. In fact, she might be faster than the colt.
Right.
Keep that name in mind for later in the year. I like Flying Connection to 10.
Okay.
Coming from the southwest, New Mexico, Sunland Park, I think will get totally ignored in the wagering. I think there's a chance he could get loose on the lead. And as you know, Steve, there's nothing I like more than loose
on the lead.
And playing from in front. It's not a race I have a strong opinion on. Really, the Derby's kind of the same way. It's not one of those years when I love a horse like California Chrome or Justify, you're going to know about it.
Yeah, and I think the trainer, I want to say, is Todd Fincher, who in New Mexico is a big deal.
He's Todd Pletcher in New Mexico. He's the man.
Yeah.
It's interesting that they have similar sounding names, but he is the heat in New Mexico for sure.
And by the way, Wet Paint, which is 5-2, that is Flavian Pratt aboard.
That is Pratt, and he's going to have to come. She comes from way, way back, and again, I'm not a fan.
Right.
I'm coming from way, way back.
No.
Everybody loves closers. They love teams coming from 20 points behind, lose by 8. I prefer the horse that was the team that was ahead by 20 and wins by 8.
But well, the bottom, what you're counting on when you're doing that is you're counting on everybody in front getting tired.
Correct, which often happens, but maybe all but 3 get tired or all but 2.
Yeah.
It's just a harder way in sports and horse racing. And I learned about sports and horse racing by watching it over the years.
Yeah,
the horse in front, when they hit the stretch, wins way more than the horse coming from behind.
In the 600 to 700 basketball games we've done, how often have you and I referenced play with the lead?
It's huge. And anybody that doesn't think it is, that just doesn't watch enough sports. And everybody loves the late rally. The team, hey, they came from 18 down with 12 to go. That does happen. It's just not very often.
No, not very often. DJ? You have now helped the masses, I think.
Me too. We'll see about that.
The great Dick Jerardi, my broadcast partner for basketball, coming up on our 20th season together. How about that? Today's show brought to you by Brewers Outlet, Reagan Street in Sunbury, the beverage supermarket. Stock up for the Derby now. Have your own Derby party. Imports, domestics, microbrews, the best selection of beer anywhere, wine coolers, water, soft drink, snacks. They roast their peanuts fresh and hot every day. Pickle bar, led by the barrels and the dills, indeed second to none. Neal Coolong joining us in the Sunbury Motors studio next on News Radio 1070 WKOK.
Brewers Outlet, the beverage superstock superstores, ready for all of your warm weather activities. Camping, picnics, grilling, visit Brewers Outlet first. For microbrews, imports, domestic specialties, they got them. Grab some pickles at the Pickle Bar, Steve Jones's favorite place. Snacks, Brewers Outlet has that covered. Soda, sports drinks, check. Weekly specials, too. And there's lots of convenient parking. So get all the refreshments everyone will love for your next outdoor gathering at Brewers Outlet, the beverage superstock superstore, Reagan Street, Sunbury.
When it comes to car buying, there's the other guy's way, and then there's the SMC way. The other guys force you into a vehicle you really don't want. The Sunbury Motors way lets you take the time you need to browse, ask questions, and take the test drive and think on it. For over 100 years, the Mertz family and all their employees have made your experience the most pleasant one you'll ever have. The other guys won't offer you the best price for your trade, no matter how much they say they will. The SMC way is their promise to provide you with the most money the market shows your vehicle is worth. The SMC way is to offer you all applicable factory rebates on new vehicles and generous discounts. Looking for a pre-owned vehicle? The SMC way checks each vehicle in a 200-mile radius to determine the lowest price, then beat it. It's the lowest price promise, just part of the SMC way. The choice is up to you. The other guy's way or the SMC way? The SMC way wins every time. Sunbury Motors Company in the North 4th Street Auto Plaza, Sunbury, and at sunburymotors.com. Selling more cars and satisfying more customers for over 100 years.
Sports talk where your voice counts. This is the Steve Jones Show on News Radio 1070 WKOK. Now from the Sunbury Motors Studio, here's Steve Jones.
I know it's a Friday edition, but normally we do have, when we've had him on the show, Tuesdays with Neil. And that, of course, would mean Neal Coolong. I know it's a Friday, sir, but welcome. Great to have you with us.
The most impactful Tuesdays with Neal we've seen yet. Because I don't think we've had a Tuesday following a draft that was as high in enjoyment as this one was. And I understand full well the hyperbole that's behind such a statement, but I don't think anybody in the audience that's listened to me would accuse me of being overly optimistic about the Steelers, by and large. But even I'll say that draft went better than anyone that I have seen, certainly in my professional lifetime, as somebody who was born after 1974, maybe the best that I've been alive for. And it's all on paper. You know, they're not out there in the field and blah, 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 all that. But, wow, that really could not have gone any better. It's a yeah. Great day. I think that we're seeing a shift in the recent fortune of the franchise now. I mean, there's a lot of things that need to still come together. But that's a big class. There's a lot of talent in what they brought in.
So let's start at the top, Neal, because I thought the order with which they did the top was intelligent by getting Broderick Jones first, then Joey Porter, because even if it wasn't Porter, they were still going to get a really good corner somewhere. What did you think just about the sequencing of it?
Yeah, as you've heard me say, and I don't want to disparage him, I really didn't think Joey Porter Jr. is worth the 17th overall pick. I'm not surprised he was available at 32. Might be a little bit lower, but really you're splitting hairs at that point. You can't say that a guy isn't worth 27, but he is worth 31. You know, there's kind of a range thing. You look at the middle of the draft. Call it the middle of the draft. I don't think Porter has been worth that to me, in my mind. Jones, on the other hand, definitely would not have gone lower than 14 or 15. That was even maybe a little bit of a slide. With a surprise pick or two ahead of him, but you're looking at a tackle, I mean, just by all given measurements and standards, a guy that was born to play offensive tackle. I mean, he's got the look of the new uber-athletic edge defender, edge protector. He's high cut, which is not normal for an offensive lineman, but he's got excellent athletic balance. It's something he hasn't put together yet in pass protection, but he's a mauler in the run game. I mean, he's mean. Getting a guy like him with the enormous upside potential that he has at the price of a fourth-round pick that the Patriots are happy to oblige despite the Jets, who absolutely would have taken him at 15, it really speaks volumes to the awareness I think the Steelers had, not just positionally. If we're going back to Mike Tomlin laughably saying the team didn't have any glaring holes, well, they just traded up to 14 to address one of the non-holes that they have. The awareness of what they had going into this draft, who was available, what they would need to do to get a player of substance for them and not just sit back and do the cliche, which is what everyone prized Kevin Colbert for doing, but let the draft come to them. They got aggressive and they went and got a player with all the potential in the world to be a foundational member of this team for a lot of years. And he's got, I dare to say, more potential than any offensive tackle that this team has drafted in my lifetime, for sure. It's the first one they've drafted in a long time. If they're going to wait, you have to kind of think that they're waiting for this type of a prospect. And I think Jones is absolutely that. An excellent decision all around, the right move at the right time, and you kind of had a sense they were going to try to get that pick back to some degree, whatever it is that they needed to do. They wanted to keep the stockpile of picks that they had as intact as possible in the effort to rebuild a kind of a thin roster, much more strengthened now. But at the time, they had a couple holes they needed to fill more long term, and they were able to do that.
And then they get Porter at 32, which I think you feel is the appropriate spot for him to get picked. And I think he goes into a nice situation with Patrick Peterson around and the fact that they needed one anyway.
Yeah, I mean, if you look at it from the cornerback perspective, I felt was the whole thing. I'll be honest with you. When they went on the clock, when they traded up, I assumed it was for Gonzalez. Christian Gonzalez, athletic cornerback out of Oregon. I really like his game. If we're deciding between the two, I will say this. If it were me, I probably would have taken Gonzalez. For a variety of reasons.
Mm-hmm.
I'm not upset with it being Jones. That's a nice problem to have. If you're deciding between those two, I might go a different way, but I see why they did it, and it's still a good choice. Witherspoon and Gonzalez were clearly, in my opinion, the top two cornerbacks in this draft. I thought Porter might have got passed over. The kid from Mississippi State, Foley, I forget his name, but he's not. I think Porter's a better prospect.
He's okay. I think Porter's, but with all due respect, Porter's a better prospect than Deontay Banks. So
yeah, that's fair.
And I'm saying that firsthand, watching Banks. I did three of his games, and Porter. I mean, that's when the Giants had a terrific draft on paper. That was not the best pick there.
It's interesting. Wink Martindale spoke extensively about how much they liked Banks doing the things that he does, and that's kind of the cornerback position too. You know, it's hard when you get past the top 10, top 13 or so. It's hard to say this prospect is clearly better than this prospect in that same mid-level bucket without giving heavy credence to the style in which you're going to use that cornerback.
Right.
You use them all very differently.
I understand.
To me,
that.
I think Porter is better all around.
Yeah, but Jack Hamm and I talked before
the draft on Thursday. So it's Thursday afternoon. And Jack said, can you believe that guy is up in the first round area? And I said, no, I can't. And neither one of us could recall a single play we saw him make in 3 years. I'm serious.
I heard that from a couple people.
The two of us sat there, and we did three of his games. Plus, that includes, remember, us watching video going into the game just to get a feel for personnel. Neither one of us can remember a play he made.
Yeah, I'm not surprised by that. The film that I saw of him wasn't playmaking film either, as we would say.
Right.
You saw that with Porter, and I think that's the advantage that he has. I would imagine if you want to put him side by side, the lesser amount of people would be on Team Banks, but those people would probably say something to the effect of Banks has smoother hips, he can roll. And you probably run and cover larger swatches if that's the kind of defense you're going to play.
Sure.
And in what the Steelers run, what we've seen them run, let's just say that, because we have every indication
right.
to believe they're probably going to play more of a press coverage in the upcoming season, maybe beyond. From what we have seen them play, Porter fits better. In my opinion, and he
Agreed.
Gets his hand on the ball more often.
Agreed.
That's not even a question. So I love the idea that they would take the pure prospect to trade up to get him at 14. We'll never know what they would do at 17. Maybe it was Porter 17. I'm sure they'll tell us it was, but we won't know. Jones would not have made it to 17. So there's value in that for Porter to come available. To send up the idea that, well, we're exploring all trades, which is what you do if you're in that spot. I think they telegraphed it pretty well that they were royally excited when 31 went off the board, the last pick of the first round, knowing that they had control over Porter or somebody trading up a fortune for our buddy Will Levis at the top.
That's right.
Too.
That's right.
Which, by the way, I know a lot of people were calling me after that. Will Levis, top five, always kind of made me laugh. I didn't talk to anybody that really thought that was going to be the case. I don't know if anybody saw him fall into the second round, but I'm not surprised by that either.
Well, let me tell you this way: when Richardson was picked at four, and then they took Skoronski at what, 7? That sound right?
11.
Skoronski at 11?
I took him at 11.
11. I knew he wasn't going to be a first round pick. And the reason is, unless there was a trade, which one of those teams from 12 to 31 was going to pick a quarterback?
Nope.
I mean, you have to apply some common sense when you do this. You just can't keep rooting for a guy to go someplace. There's got to be a landing spot that where the team needs it. Well, from 12 to 31, nobody needed it, and I think that I mean, that's how I looked at it.
Yeah, and that's the quarterback market. It's kind of the underside of it that we don't talk about much. It's funny because both of these statements are true. The NFL does not. The NFL has a certain amount of high level, highly accomplished quarterbacks. And there is a very bleak mid to low range in terms of production and talent. At the same time, though, only 4 or 5 teams on the higher end are going to want to draft a quarterback into any draft. It speaks to the carryover of rookie kind of getting into the flow of things in his career, figuring out what to do. Maybe it's a third year guy. Maybe they just signed somebody and are not looking to draft somebody that high. But the opportunity wasn't there, barring a trade, and that's ultimately what it comes down to. You get him in the top five, or you have to give up more in total number of assets. In order to get him after the guy fell through the top five. And my thought I can't imagine there is a coach drafting anywhere that would want Will Levis over Anthony Richardson. I can't see that. If they're playing a game tomorrow, Levis might be the choice that you've had. 2 years from now, it's really hard to see that's not going to be the case. And everybody will throw, for their own various reasons, Malik Willis into that conversation. Anthony Richardson is twice the player Malik Willis was. I mean, it's not even close. He's not that far off. He's got, you know, there are issues to his game, but you know, there's the issues of all of them. I can pick apart C.J. Stroud. I can pick apart Bryce Young, although Young is, I think, a lot closer than the other ones are. Mm-hmm. But Richardson, if he puts all of that together, the guy's a nightmare. I mean, there's nothing that he physically can't do. He just needs to learn how to do everything a little bit better. You know, he's got that runway, and time is ultimately the issue. With Levis, what's he really going to improve on? I mean, he's got a nice arm, but it's not like overpowering to the point where you could dictate your entire offense based on arm strength. He's not going to run nothing but 15 to 18 yard outs in everything that he does. He's a college athlete. He's not an NFL open field runner, and nobody can convince me otherwise because they always try to say this. Whenever the prospect's highlights are him running the ball and he plays quarterback, you have to kind of wonder, you know, the best plays he made are on the ground. It's not really what I'm drafting him for. What can he do particularly well? And I don't know if that's there for him as a pro. To me, it's, yeah, you know, you need a plus reason to want to take him in round one. Otherwise, to me, it's reasonable to say he's a second-round guy. That doesn't mean that he's a joke. It doesn't mean that he's not going to be able to do anything. But I don't know how great his ceiling is. When I look at Richardson, he's a first overall ceiling. And his bottom, I thought, always was four overall. I'm not surprised.
Yeah. Draft is more than just two rounds. It's seven. What did the Steelers do in other rounds that fit the team, but also fit what has the potential to be a terrific draft?
They did. We get past Porter. Their next two picks, it's comical to me in a way because one was so quintessential Steelers, and the other is so not Steelers. It really brackets themselves well. Everything about... You watch him play. You have great insight on this as well. He's a sit-and-throw guy. He's a gap penetrator. He's a Steelers defensive lineman. And it's almost sad in a way with John Mitchell retiring. He's not going to work with this kid because he's the type of guy Mitch absolutely loves. Physically, he's imposing, very quick off the snap. If anything, you look at it in terms of overall value of role in the NFL. That's why this kid is a second round draft pick. Other, as far as talent goes, he's going to make an impact because he's a really good football player. He just might not be a three down guy immediately. So he really kind of fits a certain definition of a round two pick. And even then, I think he fell a little bit more than you thought he would have. But he's a really good player, an excellent pick. The second the Steelers went on the clock and pretty much turned in the card right away, I knew it was going to be him. He's too perfect for him. I didn't think he'd make it this far. Yeah, great pick.
Really, I mean, big, strong, active. I mean, he's got terrific hands. A lot of things you love.
Active is a great way to put it. You know, and that's really what it's all about. It's funny because Fioko, the kid they signed from the Chargers, is a lot like that. He's not the athlete that Benton is, but. You're looking at a 1-2 probably inside defensive tackles to you know, rotate around and build up with. They've suddenly got some pretty impressive depth on that defensive line. They're going to cut a good defensive lineman this year. It's a testament to sticking to what they do. They've emphasized the position. They've drafted it pretty reasonably high lately, and they added to it in free agency the last couple of years. You know, they brought in Montrevious Adams after they had brought in Tyson Alualu. The Fioko guy now, three draft picks the last 3 years, Loudermilk, DeMarvin Leal last year, and now Benton. They have depth. You know, they're going to be able to work those positions very well. But for me, I think that probably the biggest sense of confidence fans should get in the direction of this team is the fact that one reason or another, when a player like Washington falls to the third round, whether the injury or not, the versatility that guy I understand that the general, you know, lack of pleasure people find in Matt Canada. Any NFL-level offensive coordinator, if they didn't stay up half that night drawing up stuff they're going to be able to do with that guy on the field.
Yep.
He is legitimately one of the most unique players I think they've ever brought in.
Yep.
I mean, you realize he's a pretty one diet away from being a decent-sized NFL tackle.
Yep.
Plus, athlete. Made like that. I mean, this is like a Julius Peppers type comparison, fairly.
Yeah, you're right.
You watch him move in space. It's incredible how quick he is, how nimble he is, for how big and how long-limbed he is. He catches the ball very well.
He would be a college basketball power forward.
To be honest with you, the first thing I said, how did this guy not play basketball?
He had to have been
a pretty good basketball player. It's just me. But in 12 personnel, you put him and Pat Freiermuth out on the field together in an RPO like Canada has been trying to implement. It put Deontay Johnson, George Pickens, and Najee Harris on the field. I'm not saying that all these players are all pros. I'm saying, though, that they will all play those specific positions very well for that kind of an offense.
Yeah.
And the trigger man is Pickett. If Pickett can know what to do in each of these situations, they're going to be tough to stop. That's not going to be easy.
Yeah. And by the way, don't fall asleep on Nick Herbig, the fourth-round pick out of Wisconsin as an outside linebacker. Nick, I mean, Neil, we got to run. But again, I think Herbig was a really good fourth-round pick. So that's he'll make the team. Neil, as always... Thank you so much. It's always wonderful to put the shoes up on the desk and enjoy Tuesdays with Neil.
We're kicking back this week. Thanks for having me, guys.
The great Neal Coolong, and today's show has been brought to you by the great people at Brewers Outlet, Reagan Street in Sunbury, the beverage supermarket. Stock up now. Imports, domestics, microbrews, the best selection of beer anywhere. Wine coolers, water, soft drink, snacks. They roast their peanuts fresh and out every day. Pickle bar, led by the barrels and the dills, indeed second to none. Stock up now at Brewers Outlet, Reagan Street in Sunbury, the beverage supermarket. Thanks for joining us this week in the Sunbury Motors Studio. Back Monday on News Radio 1070 WKOK.